sustainable living is very, very important. And sustainable houses and offices are also very important. We have one interesting architect today. He uses the local mud and also the waste material. The company is also called Wall Makers. Welcome, Mr. Vinu Daniel. Vinu, just tell me, why did you name your company as Wall Makers? And tell me more about your venture.
Wall Makers is a name that we didn't put on ourselves. It was a name that came because my brother, who was working with me, because initially we didn't find much workers to work with us. We didn't find clients who would give us eco-friendly projects, you know, when they hear something like, okay, you guys are doing with mud block, they would move out of the project or say, you know, like, we don't want to build with mud blocks and stuff like that. But we were persistent that we decided that even if we will not get residences to build, we will still continue to build with whatever comes across our place. So we kind of started to do things like compound walls, flower troughs, the kind of things, you know, meager projects which came our way. And my brother was kind of in charge. His name is Praveen. So once somebody with a project came and they said it's a large property, it was a 2-acre plot, and so we were kind of excited. And then the client blurted out it was for a compound wall, you know, we would like you to build compound wall all across the 2-acre property. So this infuriated him, I guess, and he was kind of, so the client also asked, but do you guys even do, you know, construction, you know, was what they asked. And then what happened is he said, no, we will only make walls, we are wall makers, you know, that is how the name.
Kerala being a cultural place, and you were interested in music, and what made it you get into engineering in the first place and architecture next?
Really, I wasn't interested in architecture or engineering. I was at heart an artist, and I wanted to practice music. Music really, because I was born and brought up in Gulf, in Abu Dhabi. And there, you know, the kind of society that is there, and, you know, like, it's a very fast, you know, method life, machine life, or whatever you can call it. And I was finding music as one solace, which I would like to pursue, kind of away from what I was planning to do. So I came down to Trivandrum being one of the music hubs in the country. I came down to Kerala, Trivandrum, and I thought I will enroll myself in music college. And in fact, I enrolled myself in private music practice with Dr. Omanakutty teacher. I started my music lessons with her school. Some weeks into it, I learned that I got something in, you know, engineering. And I wasn't aware of anything called architecture. But somebody told me, you know, it has something to do with drawing, and I was kind of comfortable with, you know, drawing and stuff. So I kind of joined architecture in the pretext of getting out of it, because my parents were putting pressure that you should join some sort of professional college or professional course. So my plan was I will join architecture and then I will scoot architecture to take on music full time. That was my idea.
He was using a lot of local materials to build low-cost houses. How did you get influenced by the architect Laurie Baker? And, you know, you said you've been inspired by him. What made you to start your own architecture venture?
And the truth is, when we started studying in the college wasn't very appreciative, or the general trend in architects wasn't very appreciative of Laurie Baker. It is only, the general public were really after him, but you could see that the general populace of architects were kind of, you know, pissed off with him doing all these kind of unconventional things. Because for me, the more I stayed in the architecture college, I was more convinced that it is a society filled with bitter ego and unethical construction techniques, you know. It didn't convince me. Whatever the conventional stuff that was taught in college didn't convince me at all. And I was hoping to leave this within second year or third year, which was exactly the time when I kind of met Laurie Baker. And he explained how being sustainable, and even today, those are the kind of principles that keep me awake.
Okay, and also your stint in Aurovilla. I mean, that's what you gained a lot of experience in terms of sustainable buildings, the mud blocks which you did. And also you were there during the tsunami days. Just tell me what exactly you did in Aurovilla, and how did you help the tsunami time? You know, the whole destruction happened, a lot of houses were been damaged. So tell me more about your Aurovilla experience, Mr. Vinu.
To tell you the truth, again, I was quite misinformed about Auroville. Auroville was not, in our charts anywhere, even though we were studying in South India in Kerala. But my thesis was based on mud or huts of Bunga in Rajasthan and Gujarat. So after my thesis got nice reviews, one of the teachers said, his name is Charji sir, he told me not to stay in Kerala and get, according to him, polluted. So he told me just to go to this, there is reconstruction work post tsunami happening in Auroville, and a place called Auroville Earth Institute, which is headed by Satprem Mining, is doing mud block this thing. Anyway, you did your thesis on mud block, so really try to learn more about that kind of construction properly. That kind of alternate construction is what we need in the future, is what my professor Mr. Shaji Thiel told me. And I left to this Auroville Earth Institute, and thankfully, gracefully, Satprem accepted me into his office because there was a long waiting period. But still, I got an easy entry, and I immediately got into working with what was happening in the post-tsunami period, post-tsunami reconstruction. And UNDP was also involved, United Nations Development Program. So as they were involved, they kind of taught us about mud techniques. Satprem Mining taught us about how to make mud blocks out of, soil 1 feet from the...
Tell me more about your recent project, Shikara. It's an interesting project where it's around 2,200 square feet, and you built up the local material and also used your own local patented technology, which is also called shuttered debris walls.
I should start about the patent technology which came to us, because I told you, from Auroville Earth Institute, I learned about how to make mud blocks. So the mud blocks which is made is something called dry earth. Like, the earth has to be very dry to make these mud blocks. They are mixed with a 5% of cement, and these mud blocks are made by compression. Kerala, being a very, very wet place, making this kind of dry soil, keeping it dry all the time during the mud block making sessions was kind of difficult. And I had to find some other alternative to continue this kind of, and necessity leads to invention, something like that. And what happened is, slowly we started to understand that even soil is getting low, like procuring soil is not that easy, even soil, procuring it from somebody else's property is not exactly an ethical process for. So I started thinking that why not incorporate waste also, and slowly my team of workers were becoming very, very proficient. And there was a project with me and another architect, her name is Shobhita Jacob. So we both were involved in doing something with the waste of laterite waste, because that was in a northern part of Kerala where there is a lot of laterite. And when I went to some of the quarries, I found that they have been wasting a lot of laterite debris. And me and this lady thought that why not we combine this idea into rammed earth and poured earth and do a mixture of salt. And it took us around 3 to 4 years to come up with a decent solution called shattered debris wall, where you mix a bit of cement with a bit of shattered, shattered waste debris. We mix a bit of soil, all those things you mix, so that you don't need that much of sealed soil.
Many people think interior is more about your paints and your glass and all those MDF and all. So tell me more about your project which you did for the interiors. It's called Tease Me.
Tell you the truth, actually I don't know conventional process. I am very very bad in being doing paint or putty. If you give me a four wall place, it's very difficult for me to design. So in Tease Me, again, I had the opportunity to think, because I have been using oxide a lot, and I was thinking, cloth can be oxided in some sense. You can do something about the cloth and make it into something like an oxide. So I thought, you know, the cloth, I fashioned it in such a way that it becomes like a seat, and then, you know, we can, you know, like oxide on it, apply some basic chemicals and dip it in cement and, you know, like do some oxiding. And by that time, I have already developed people who are ready to do kind of experimental work with me, because most of my people know that Sar will come with something new.
And what is your, you know, advice or your future plans, you know, to have a sustainable houses instead of building these huge concrete buildings like Bangalore has these huge concrete buildings with a lot of glass in it. And, you know, the outside temperature will be 22 and inside they make the glass and they put AC air conditioners to make the temperature 22. So what is your advice or your plans to make this city sustainable living?
I don't believe we can force sustainability, first of all. Let me clear that part up. We cannot force sustainability. People have to
recognize. You cannot force sustainability. That's what you're saying. Force.
No, you can't. You can't force sustainability. Because people will always value their pride, their status above sustainability. You know, until those things change. So when you are living in a city, I am living in a city, I own a place in Bangalore, you can already imagine that person is kind of, you know, like talking about status more than that he is having a shelter. So all these things lead to unsustainable lifestyles. You know? All these things kind of put, you know, my neighbor has 4-bedroom, I should have 5-bedroom.
What are your future plans? Like you want to expand, you know, your construction fields to other states. Of course, you're doing in other states also. Any specific projects you have it in mind, Vinu?
No, I want to build all around the world. I want to change what your basic construction norms are. That is actually what we are trying to change. We want to burn those kind of concepts. So none of us, our generation, ever planted a tree. So we don't have the right to cut a tree.
Waste is an important aspect in terms of using the same thing, reusing it, you know, the triple R's, you know, reduce, recycle and reuse, you know, that's what Vinu is following. And also it's also practical, isn't it, the way you have done a lot of projects. The Shikara is one example of recently you've done it. Thanks Vinu for speaking to Smart System. Thank you very much and all the very best for your future projects. Thank you.